Morning. I confess to you that this was probably the single most difficult message for me to prepare since I've arrived here at Faith. I would say the reason for that is not because I couldn't find material for it, but the sermon title says it all. Jesus is here. So I got to thinking, how am I going to get up there and make a message, 25, 30 minute message out of this? Because honestly, I could come up here, I could say, Jesus is here. Ryan Singerman can shout amen. We can say a prayer and I'll go home. We'd be done, right? Okay. Or I could take us back to Easter Sunday when we began this series, and every time I say Jesus is here, I can use a different week to illustrate my point. For example, Jesus is here because he is alive. Jesus is here because he is your friend. Jesus is here because he is the point. Jesus is here because he's happy, right? Okay? I wasn't doing that nearly as good as Craig Petty John was earlier. That would be easy. But I can't, as I reason this, it can't possibly be that easy to say Jesus is here and be done with it. There's got to be more to that claim than simply he is here. Now, if we were to ask the question of people, where is Jesus today? I would venture to say that you would be entertained by many of the answers or responses that you would get. Of course, that's going to depend on who you ask. If you turn to your neighbor and say, where is Jesus today? Most of us in this room are probably going to give a very similar answer, and that's okay. So depending on who you ask, you're going to get a variety of responses. For example, if you were to ask somebody who practices the world religion of Baha'i, you would be told, well, Jesus died, his physical body is in the ground, but his spirit or his soul has risen and is in heaven. Because to a Baha'i, heaven is reserved for holy men. And Jesus was a holy man, so his spirit or his soul then is in heaven. If you were to ask a Mormon might say, well, Jesus was born a man, he later became a god, he was given his own planet, now he lives on that planet with his wife who is eternally pregnant, and they're populating their planet. Okay, sure. A Jehovah's Witness might say, well, Jesus did not rise from death physically, but he did so spiritually. But then, in 1914, he came back to this earth, moved to Pittsburgh, and is ruling things through the Watchtower Society. A Muslim might be inclined to say Jesus never died. He was actually just taken up to heaven in much the same way as Enoch or Elijah from the Old Testament. An Orthodox Jew is going to say, yes, Jesus was a man, yes, Jesus lived, yes, Jesus died, and there he stays. His bones are in the ground, buried somewhere overseas. He never rose from the dead, but he did die. But if you were to ask me, or you were to ask Pastor Steve, or many of the people sitting in this room, where Jesus is today, I, Pastor Steve, some of you might be inclined to say, Jesus is here. And not just because it's the sermon title for today. Jesus is here. Now, most of us in this room could give an example as to why we say Jesus is here. We all have those God moments or those Jesus moments in our lives where we see things happen and we smile and we go and we tell our Christian brother or sister, I saw Jesus in action today. I had two of those examples just yesterday, as a matter of fact. The first one came as I was sitting in my office doing some schoolwork, and there were pictures being taken all day yesterday, and somebody on their way out stopped in my office and they wanted to share with me a little bit. And so they said, hey, let me tell you a little bit about me. I'm like, okay. And they told me that at the point of their realization that they needed something bigger than themselves in their life, they were cleaning fish and drinking a beer. And they said, I literally felt Jesus grab my arm as I went to take a sip and put my hand back down on the table and say, you have taken your last sip of alcohol. You're done. You're done. And in that moment, he never touched it again. Now, that's pretty awesome, right? You see the power of God at work. But then there's more simpler ways. For example, I went and pumped gas yesterday. It's at the Marathon station in the corner of Stellhorn and Maplecrest. And as I was pumping my gas, two kids were walking down the street through the Marathon parking lot. One was, I'm going to say, 12 or 13, and the other one around 9 or 10. They appeared to be brother and sister. So by the time I finished pumping my gas and went in to pay, they are positioned in line in front of me. And they had each had an ice cream bar in their hand. So they made their way to the counter, and apparently their mom or somebody had given them a credit card to use. Declined. The clerk said, do it again. Declined. The clerk said, all right, let's give it one more try. Swipe, decline. Now, most of us would probably say the clerk, his next response, and he had every right to do so, would be, oh, if you don't have another way to pay, I'm sorry, but you have to put the ice cream back in the cooler. But he didn't.
He said, put the credit card in your pocket, enjoy your ice cream. Now, I don't want to over-spiritualize anything, but you know what? If Jesus is here, could he not have been standing on the other side of the counter with that clerk whispering in his ear, let the kids have their ice cream? Right? Let them have it. And so I stepped up to the counter and I said, my credit card's declined. Are you going to let me drive away without paying for my gas? No, he didn't laugh. Wasn't funny. But in case we can't reason that Jesus is here, because we have a difficult time thinking through the abstract things of our faith, like, for example, children, okay? I've been doing chapel on occasion for the preschool here. Miss Sarah lets me come and talk to the kids every now and again, and I love the innocence in which they approach faith. They are so honest and innocent, and, you know, they can't reason anything beyond what's in front of them. So Dr. Seuss, a snowman, whatever we can use to illustrate truths about God, we're going to use. But if you were to tell a child Jesus is here, they're going to say, no, he's not. They're going to say, why? What do you mean, no, he's not? I can't see him. I can't touch him. I can't talk to a physical Jesus, and therefore Jesus is not here. Makes sense, right? They'd make pretty good apologists because they can reason. Even as adults, some of us have a hard time wrapping our mind around the truth that Jesus is here, but we go at it from a more scriptural standpoint. We might say, well, I know Jesus is not here because we read of his ascension in Scripture. We know that after he had been here 40 days and made several appearances to his people, that in his final meeting with them, or sometime hereabout, he ascended back up into heaven to be seated at the right hand of his Father. We read the story, we know what happens, we know the disciples are standing there talking to Jesus, and the next minute, like a hot air balloon, he starts raising up in the clouds. They're like, what is going on? Looking for a rope so they can pull him back down, sandbags to put around his ankles. Even the angels come and say, why are you looking at the sky? So we know that Jesus left. And if you would reason that, if you was an adult and say, I know Jesus ascended, you would be right. And his ascension is a great place to start to unlocking the truth that Jesus is, in fact, here with us. Perhaps not physically, spiritually, but it goes beyond that as well. If you would, turn with me to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28. I'm going to read verses 17 through 20. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Before this ascension takes place, in one of his final post-resurrection appearances to his disciples and a small group of close followers in this intimate setting, Jesus makes a powerful declaration. He issues a world-changing command, and he makes a very bold promise. At this meeting, Jesus was being worshipped as God, yet some still had doubts. Now, the Greek word we use here, we interpret doubt, is distasso. And that literally means to hesitate to act on one's faith. See, I will tell you that it's highly unlikely that any of the disciples would have doubted the reality of the resurrection. But some of the crowd on this day would have been Galileans. And they may have not have heard of any of the post-resurrection appearances. And so this is the first time that they're seeing with their own eyes that Christ the Lord had risen. So Jesus, again, reminds the disciples of this urgent need for them to carry out the gospel. He addresses the group, noting specifically a very powerful declaration. He says, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. All authority. Now, we have to be diligent in our teaching of this verse. And so I feel it's important to point out that Matthew makes no mention of the ascension. So if you're following along with me, it's going to end here, and you're not going to see an ascension. Now, I don't think this is anything that stands in contradiction to what Mark or Luke propose, but I think the reason why Matthew does that is because Matthew knows that Christ is the king. And he knows that his kingdom is here on earth. And so naturally, as he's writing his accounts of this situation, Matthew leaves the king in his kingdom, which is here on earth, where the king should be. Matthew is the gospel of the king. Jesus was born as a king, Jesus lived as a king, Jesus died as a king, and Jesus rose as a king. And you can be assured that Jesus, in all power and glory, will come back as our Lord of Lords and King of Kings.
Amen.
You see, Jesus says, I have all authority. It's been given to me here in heaven and on earth. I will be with you until the end of the age. The ascension was the final incontestable evidence that Christ was the victor over Satan and his hosts. It had to happen. It's the measure of his victory, but also the measure of the power which has been bestowed upon his saints to carry out the work that Christ started on this earth in his life. Don't gloss this over. Listen to that again. It's the measure of his power that has been bestowed upon his saints. Who do you think his saints are? Look to your right and look to your left. You, we, are his saints. The believers, the followers of Christ, we are his saints. So see, the ascension, then, we've got the key and the lock and we're starting to turn it and open the door now so we can see how important that is to Christ being here with us on this earth. We are with Jesus, and Jesus is with us. He has left. He has ascended up into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. And that has certain implications for you and for me. Now, I know that physically, right now in this moment, we are all seated at 6600 Trier Road in Fort Wayne, Indiana, in a building that we call Faith Baptist Church. Positionally, however, we are seated with Christ at the right hand of the Father. You don't have to take my word for it. You can look at Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6. It says, and God raised us up with Christ to be with him, to be seated with him in heaven. Because Christ raised us, because we are positionally seated at the right hand of the Father, by his love and his grace, and certainly not because we are deserving of any of this, he has seated us with him so that we share in his authority. All authority and power in heaven and on earth has been given me. And because we are positionally seated, because we are in Christ and Christ is in us, we have inherited that power. This is huge. This is huge. This is life-changing. Christ didn't do that for us so that we would become powerfully arrogant. He did it so that we could triumph over Satan and his brood of demons. Christ is in us. If you look in the Gospel of John, right before Jesus leaves, he looks at his 12 who are cowering in the corner. They're scared. They feel lost. The word that uses to describe their anger means like a deep, gut-wrenching hurt that comes from deep, deep, deep down inside. And Jesus says, you don't understand. I have to leave so that the one who is coming after me can come. He can get here. Jesus ascends into heaven, sends his Spirit, who is now living and dwelling inside of each believer who chooses to follow Christ. Salvation is here. Salvation is alive inside of each and every one of us, and we carry with us the power and the authority of our salvation, Jesus Christ. Listen, the Lord is the everlasting God. He is the creator of the heavens and the earth and everything under the sun and to the end of the ages. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth, he gave man a choice. Man chose to be his own God. And when man chose to be his own God, doors were opened that should have never have been opened. And when those doors were opened, things, powerful things, walked through those doors. Sickness, addiction, greed, lust, failure, fear, malice, slander, disease, hurt, pain, poverty, anger, bitterness, hatred, slander, and death. They came through these doors. Things so powerful, nothing could touch them. Things too powerful for science, for cosmology, for medicine, for Scientology, for drugs, for alcohol, for money, for Buddha, for Muhammad, for Confucius. Things too powerful. Things so powerful that the only thing that could touch them would be something more powerful than they were. The only thing more powerful than they were would be something that defeated death. The only thing that defeated death is the Son of God, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The ascension was necessary for the Holy Spirit to come upon the church in a different way than in times past. But it is also an indication, an extent of the power which has been made available to complete the work that God, or Christ, started. He is the only thing powerful enough to handle these forces that came through these doors when God gave man a choice and we made wrong. So now we're faced to deal with it on a daily basis. Maybe not in your life, but perhaps in the life of someone who you know struggles in some way and in some fashion. If you are in Christ and Christ is in you, then you are positionally seated, and again I say, have inherited the power and the authority to face the darkness of this world. You have the power and the authority to tread on Satan. Anybody hear that? You have the power and the authority to tread on Satan. So many times we make excuses. I don't know how to help this person. I don't know what to say to them. I don't know what to do for them. I just wish I could take it all away from them. You have been positionally seated and given the power and the authority to look the enemy right in the eyes and say, "Get behind me, Satan." You can do it because Christ is here, Christ is in you, and you are in Christ. We have the power and the authority to break the chains that bind us. We have it. We possess that power. We have the power and the authority to confront the enemy in the name of Christ Jesus in supplication for those who are living a life of strife. Do you know what supplication means? It means for somebody else. You have the power to go to battle for your brothers, your sisters, your neighbors, your friends, a stranger. You have the power to fight that battle, and most importantly, you have the authority to conquer in the battle and be the victor. This very idea is how I met Jesus. Some of you might know my story. Some of you are like, "Where did this guy come from?" This is how I met Jesus. A motley crew of followers who recognized that they had the power and the authority because Christ was in them, reached out to me in a moment of total darkness. 14 years ago, I was somebody that you would not want to associate with. 14 years ago, I decided I was going to be my own God and I was failing miserably. 14 years ago, I was lying to my wife, to her family, to my family, to everybody, as I tried to hide who I had become and what I was about. 14 years ago, I committed a crime that would give me 18 months in prison. At least that's what my attorney said, because there was no hope for me. I had turned myself in. And the first encounter with anybody who showed me the power of the Christ was a man by the name of George Garrett. And that man was a 25-year veteran at the time with the Columbus, Ohio Police Department. And he listened to my story. And then, after I was done giving my testimony, he shut the door. And he said, "I'm going to share with you something that I haven't in 25 years shared with anybody. But somebody is telling me that I need to talk to you right now." And he said, "Do you know Jesus?" And I said, "I don't want to be preached to right now." And he said, "You didn't hear me. Do you know Jesus?" And I said, well, I was raised Catholic. He said, I don't care. Do you know Jesus? I said, why does this matter? He said, I'll tell you why it matters. Because the person you committed the crime against may forgive you. The judge may give you a second chance. Your family may receive you and give you a second chance. But Christ will take this, make it his own, make it go away, and give you a fresh start for the rest of your life.
Amen.
And I thank him, and I walk away. I began to prepare for my little 18-month hiatus from life, working as many jobs as I could work, doing as many things as I could do. And I was coming home from work one night at 11 o'clock, and I was looking for a ball game on the radio, and I found a Christian radio station. I had never listened to Christian radio ever before. Well, it didn't mean anything to me. And on the radio was a song that now I know the title of is Love Song by a group called Third Day. And the minute I turned the radio on, it was at the bridge of the song, and in not so many terms, Matt Powell, singing as though it were the eyes and the voice of Jesus Christ, said the following words to me. You have no idea what I have done for you. But I love you so much that I will do it over and over and over again. And I froze. And I panicked. And I shook. And I made my way home. And I talked to Kelly. And she assured me that everything was going to be okay. Just calm down. It would be all right. A few more weeks goes by. Closer to what now is my court date. And my attorney has said, there's no hope, dude. The best we're going to do is 18 months. Felony one. So I'd be marked for the rest of my life, right? So Kelly was already gone at work one morning, and I decided I was going to pray before I went to work. I had never prayed really before. And I hit my knees on our bedroom floor, and I said, God, I don't know if you're out there. I don't know if you're listening. I don't know if this thing that you call grace and mercy is real, but if it is, I need an extra dose of it, and I need it right now. And if you help me, I promise you that I'll do my best to give you the rest of my life. I went to work, and at 10 o'clock that morning, my name came over the PA to go into my boss's office. Thinking I was in trouble for something else, I go in there. And he said, you got a phone call, it's a personal matter, I want you to sit right here and take it. It was my attorney. My attorney said the following, I don't know who you've been talking to. I don't know if you've hired another attorney or you have any other counsel, but your victim has decided that they will be willing to drop the charges pending you do a few things. If you're hearing me this morning, and you can honestly tell me that Jesus is not here, I don't know what I would do, because I'm living proof that he is.
Amen.
My attorney did nothing for me. In the time that I was paying him a retainer, all he did was call me once in a while and file a paper on my behalf. I never saw a courtroom. I never saw a judge. I never saw a jail cell. I never got a criminal conviction at all whatsoever. I was able to keep my family. I was able to keep my life. But the most important thing I got out of that was a Savior who was going to love me for the rest of my life, no matter what.
Amen.
Why? Because somebody knew that they had the power and the authority of Jesus Christ living in them, because he is here, he is alive, and he is well. This is how I met Jesus. I was not born free, I was set free.
Amen.
Why? Because Christ is here. The ascension was a desperately needed event. It was desperately needed for those who most need assurance of his spiritual presence and power. And surely those of us who have never walked the dusty road with him, heard his dry, shaky voice, feel his touch, or witnessed a miracle, it is good to know that Jesus is here, because he is all things love, all things light, all things hope, all things peace, all things true, all things joy, all things life. He is our Lord, he is our God, and he is here.
Amen.
Let's pray. Father God, thank you for this day, Lord. Thank you for using my life to share with others just how awesome you are. I know, Lord, that every day I wake up a sinner. But I'm a new creation in your sight and your plan for my life. Do I get it right every day? Absolutely not. Do I stumble and fall at least 100 times a day? But what I know is that you are here, standing beside me, able to pick me up, able to dust me off and say, it's okay, I love you. I'll do it over and over and over again because that's how much I love you. Father God, when we have the opportunity as your saints to talk to somebody who desperately needs to surrender to the power and the authority of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, help us to do that. Help us to not talk about the weather or shopping or what we had for lunch, but to look them in the eye and say, by the power of Jesus Christ, I want to offer you a gift that never needs returned. Hang on for the ride, because when Christ changes you, it's going to be the ride of your life.
Yes.
I believe that Christ chases after us as fervently as we often chase after him. And for that reason, I know our Lord and Savior loves us. Father God, give us the passion. Give us the boldness. Give us the zeal to put you in front of those we know are struggling. It's not us that saves. It's you. Pray these things in the name of He who is more powerful than anything that could ever walk through the door, Jesus Christ. Amen.
As we stand to sing this last song this morning, Tony's sermon got me thinking that this song that we're going to do, it's a very old hymn, it's a very well-known hymn, I should say, and I think this just hammers in that point that amazing grace, how sweet the sound, and saved a wretch like me. It's just a nice reminder that Jesus is all these things.
He's alive. He's your friend. He is the point. He is happy. He is here.
Yeah.
So let's remember that as we worship our Father this morning. Peace.